Moonstompers everywhere, a warm welcome back to the channel. I'm Mrs Moonstomper.
And I'm Mr Moonstomper.
Sup up your beer.
And collect your fags.
There's a row going on. Down in Slough.
It's none other than the Modfather himself, Mr Paul Weller, and the jam. So welcome to our bank holiday special, welcome. As we said we'd do. We hope you enjoy this one, and let's delve into Mr. Paul Weller and the jam in the nicest sense. So, Mrs. Moonstomper,
yes.
The jam. What do you know about the jam?
Well, firstly, the name, the title. It was thought of by Paul Weller's sister. Having breakfast one day, minding your own business, and Paul Weller sat there thinking, I don't know what to call this band. So while he was munching on the toast, his sister piped up and says, why not the jam?
It's a good job they weren't eating Marmite, guys, isn't it, really? Or
maybe it'd have been called Marmite.
Beef dripping, even, no? Marmalade? Oh, there was a band called Marmalade.
Yeah, she did say there was a band called Marmalade.
Absolutely.
And a band called Bread.
So why do girls always come up with the best name for bands?
Because girls are the best.
AC/DC, was it their sister who came up with...
Was it the Young Brothers, was it?
It was the Young Brothers' sister.
Sister, yes.
And she came up with the name for AC/DC, yes. By looking on none other than the back of a vacuum cleaner.
Okay.
So, but anyway, we digress, because this is not about AC/DC.
No.
This is about one of the greatest modern rock and roll bands, The Jam.
Oh, yes.
And what they started and what they actually did was an absolute, it was amazing. So that's where they got the name from. So they started in 1972 in Woking in Surrey.
Yes.
And
their secondary school.
It was indeed.
A group of them got together.
They did indeed, but Paul Weller was the only original member at that point in time, led to believe.
Oh.
Rick Bockler didn't join till later, and Bruce Foxton didn't join till later, but they all went to the same school.
Yeah, yes.
I could be wrong there, but from my memory serves me correctly, it was kind of Paul Weller's, it wasn't Paul Weller's band, but it was just their boyhood band.
Oh,
and
yes.
It evolved into the three-piece combo. That everybody knows and loves, which is Weller, Foxton and Buckler.
Okay.
So Buckler on the drums, Foxton on the bass and Weller on the guitar.
Yes.
But funnily enough, there's a thing for you.
What was this?
Foxton originally played the guitar and Weller originally played the bass.
Oh, okay.
Did you know that?
I didn't know.
And then they swapped instruments, which seems bizarre. The Jam, they were signed to...
Polydor Records,
that's correct.
Yes.
And their first records, they weren't majorly successful at that point in time. So the critical acclaim didn't really come till maybe the third LP, if I remember rightly. So the first LP, with the first single actually, was In the City.
Yes.
And In the City was the name of the LP
as well, if I remember rightly. Yes, it was.
And it was very, very, it was almost pseudo-punk at that point in time. Punk was becoming a thing, and it was very, very... almost sharp, overdriven guitars, very quick, and very, very, almost shouty.
Yes.
And I believe at that point in time, Weller got inspiration from The Who.
Yes.
And the reason I got inspiration from The Who was in, I think it was in 1974.
Oh, okay.
He actually discovered The Who, or probably really knew about The Who all along, but
yes.
He actually... really got into The Who, and he started writing the Lambretta, so he was a bit of a mod throwback.
Yes.
And at that point in time, conversely, mod was not a popular thing in 74.
No.
That had long since gone, so if you watch her other videos about mods, some of those went into skinheads. In fact, skinhead was probably much gone by then, the original skinhead OG. Northern Soul had sort of took the country by storm,
yes,
as one of the underground movements. But Weller was always interested in soul as well, and we'll come to that later in the programme, because that's quite telling in his musical taste. Conversely, they didn't have a long career, did they?
No, they didn't.
So when did they split up?
1982.
It was 82.
Yes.
But we'll get to that in a bit because the common misconception between Foxton and Weller at the time was that they fell out massively.
Okay.
But we'll come back to that shortly because I think that's quite an interesting topic and what happens after that. So in 77, the Jam went on tour with the Clash, if I remember rightly.
Yes.
And it was the White Riot tour.
Oh, yes.
So the Clash were they were a really, really big group then. They were the next big thing. Punk was riding high, and they took the Jam on tour, and there were a couple of other bands as well. So we'll put those on the screen who were on that tour, and that's how the Jam became more popular. Because more people saw them, although they had already got a couple of LPs under the belt at the time.
Yeah.
So the Jam, funnily enough, had 6 studio albums, 10 live albums, 8 compilation albums, I think they had 7 video albums, something like 3 EPs, 18 singles in the charts, wow. Top 40. That is quite some accolade.
Some feat, yes.
But they didn't become massively popular till I think it was the third LP. So the first 2 LPs, they were good. Polydora grabbed hold of them and they promoted them. And yes, they just about scraped the top 10 on the majority of things, but in the city, that got to number 20 in the UK charts, which is quite some feat for a first LP.
Oh, yes.
But this is the modern world. Actually, did a bit worse.
Oh.
But at that point in time, Weller decided, in fact, he decided when they did in the city just before, that they were all going to dress in mohair suits. Those black and white mohair suits.
Yes.
Which is kind of funny, really, because when you look at that black and white, and then you look at Two Tone, which was maybe 2 or 3 years later.
Oh, yes.
That's rather telling, isn't it?
Okay.
So, did Weller really start something at that point in time that Two Tone liked the look of?
Well, he might have done it subconscious. It seems like it's subconscious.
Exactly that. That's what I think.
Yes.
Part of the style was the, obviously it was the mod scene, and their logo was obviously the RAF Roundel, which the Who had, so the Who put their name over that. The Jam did the same as well, which I think was a masterstroke, and who doesn't like the RAF Roundel? Check the t-shirts, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, shameless plug there, we're not selling these yet, but when we get to a few thousand subs, then we'll start to, we might even give these away, might we not? So, their third LP, which was all mod cons.
Oh, right.
Right, that got to, if my memory serves me rightly, I think that got to about number 3 in the UK album charts. And that was the first LP to get critical acclaim for the Jam. That's what really catapulted those guys. But that was released in 1978. The first one, 70, so the first two, they actually released in the space of a year, which was in the city, and this is the modern world. Those were released in the same year, so that was quite quick. But in those days, they could record songs quite quick. In terms of the musicians, right, Weller was probably the front man, although he was the front man, fact. So he was the key character to the Jam. But the Jam is not the Jam without the other two, because without the rhythm section, it just doesn't make the Jam at all. And Paul probably proved that when he made the Style Council. But that was a different thing altogether.
It was,
so if you remember what we said, the first two LPs were very, very much based on the Who in their approach. But it was the stripped down version of Who. Just those three instruments and the rhythm section behind, which was Foxton and Buckler, that kept the beat of the band. But it was also very, well, not technical, it was very, very interesting as well. But Foxton didn't do, same Foxton didn't do much. In terms of lyrics, he contributed to the first 2 LPs, but by the time it got to all Modcons, he kind of took a back seat and Weller took over.
Yes.
And they were looking to Weller to take the lead. But Foxton did sing as well, didn't he?
Yes.
He sort of lead on a couple of singles.
One of the ones was called David Watts.
David
back in Watts. 1978. It was a cover of The Kinks from 1967.
So what was that about? Because that's got quite an interesting story, hasn't it?
Yes. It's about a boy at school, a head boy or prefect. It's about an admiration for him. But everybody wanted to be like David Watts. I think he was one of the popular lads in school.
And that was wasn't somebody attracted to him, or did I get that incorrect?
Well, they said allegedly David Watts was attracted to Dave Davis, the brother of Ray Davis from the Kinks. Yes.
And then they sang about that.
Oh, yes, yes.
Yeah, I don't think I'd have kept quiet about that. But that's each to their own, guys. We're not here to judge, honestly, we're not. But that's kind of
a bit of
strange. When The Jam did it, actually, it was a really, really, really good song.
I think they made a good version.
Yeah, I do. And it was good to hear Foxton sing as well. Because he also sang on, I think it was News of the World, if I remember rightly. Right, so the other thing about The Jam as well, or about Paul Weller, is he was very, dare I say, outspoken. And when I say outspoken, it just means the man knows his own mind.
Oh, yes.
And there is nothing wrong with that at all.
He speaks as he finds.
So what we're going to do now, guys, is we're going to show you a quick VT, because we like a VT in Moonstompers, do we not?
Yes, we do.
Always makes for a good video.
Yes.
So have a look at this VT of Paul Weller and The Jam, and we'll be back with you in a mo. Cheers, guys.
Yeah, I'm still a mod. I'll always be a mod. You can bury me a mod.
He's packed the Albert Hall, but also given benefits to C&D or the miners.
They're all part of the same thing as far as I'm concerned. They're all a question of dissent against this government's policies, and probably in a more general way against the whole of kind of the capitalist policies as well. And I think there's a lot of people who'd like to see a different system set up in this country, and indeed like, you know, the Western world. But I've got a chance to say something through my work, which goes out to a lot of people, not only in this country but all over the world. There's a little bit there. I've got a good opportunity to actually express my feelings. And that's what I do. I mean, it's like I've said in the past, if I was an author, I wouldn't get questions so much about is this the right thing to do, you know, should politics be in music? It's only because I'm working within pop music that people question it and say, well, pop music is supposed to be about frivolity and the joys of life, you know. But I mean, you can only write about what you see around you.
be a mod. Come bury me a mod.
Welcome back, Moonstompers. As Mr. Moonstomper has stated about Mr. Weller, he is very outspoken.
I think so as well, but as well as verbally, a lot of his songs, like In the City, that was actually about police brutality.
Okay.
Did you know or did you not know? And then the Eton Rifles as well, which came a bit later, which is one of my favourite tracks, actually. I love that. And there's a bit of a funny story there. So he actually wrote that in his caravan, it wasn't his caravan, but he was on holiday in a caravan in wherever it was, somewhere in England with his girlfriend, I believe. And I think it was pouring down with rain. And I think he flicked on the TV, so there's nothing else to do.
Oh, okay.
Then he saw a protest march go past the Eton College or Eton School. So if you don't know what Eton School is or Eton College, it's a private all-boys school in Surrey,
yes.
I believe. We'll put details on the screen if you really want to know. But the point of that school was it bred how many Conservative Prime Ministers? Probably quite a few, and politicians, etc., etc. So you kind of know the school that we just said it is.
Oh, yes.
And so you have to listen to the words in that song, but a few years later, none other than David Cameron actually used that for one of his, I think it was his election campaign.
Oh.
In the late 2000s, if I remember rightly. Could have been 2008, 2010. And when he was actually pulled, it could have been 2006 actually, when he was actually pulled up about it by whichever newspaper it was or whichever person it was who pulled him up and said, why have you used that? Do you even know that song is about? His quote was that, you know, you don't have to be working class to like the Jam. Paul Weller actually said, what part of the Eton Rifles did David Cameron not get?
Oh, right.
And that's quite telling, because obviously David Cameron didn't get it, but you know, there you go. But I'm not politically swayed either, which is why I think they're all a bunch of idiots myself. But Paul Weller was also a member of the Red Wedge as well, which was a pseudo-political movement that was made in the 80s, and I think it was something to do with none other than Billy Bragg.
Oh, yes.
And Jimmy Somerville was in it as well, from the Communards.
Oh, right.
And I think it was an attempt at getting youngsters to vote for the Labour Party in a bid to oust Margaret Thatcher in the mid-80s, there or thereabouts.
Yeah.
I'll probably put the exact dates on the screen, but that was kind of strange. And I think Weller, when he joined, I don't know if he was persuaded, but he did say that Billy Bragg was awfully persuasive.
Okay.
So I don't know if Weller actually wanted to join that or not. But at that time in the mid-80s, he was going through probably a bit of a crisis, in all honesty. So that's going forward. So back to the Jam, Mrs. Moonstomper.
Yes.
So a bit later in the Jam's career,
yes,
you could hear the sound had changed,
mm-hmm,
and it had gone to more of a softer side.
Oh, yes.
More on the Kinks side of things. So, and you can hear that with acoustic numbers such as
That's Entertainment.
So, there's a... With that song...
Yes.
What was that about? Can you remember?
Oh, yes. Paul Weller, when walking home from a night out, he was drunk and he sang about what he saw on his way home, like different things. And
did he not write that really quickly or something?
I think it was only a few minutes, yes.
I think it was 10 minutes to write that song. That's some going, that is 10 minutes, back of a fag packet or whatever, after a few beers. But you could see the music had changed,
yes,
and Foxton had kind of taken the back seat by then. And Buckler just remained as quiet as ever. And when they got to probably their last LP, which was the Gift.
Oh, yes.
Which was their only number one studio LP, if I remember rightly. they were as high as can be in terms of success. And that's when Weller left the band.
Oh, right.
That's absolutely bizarre, but in hindsight, was it the right thing to do? Weller always thought so, and his rationale behind that was quite simple, that he just didn't want to become boring, unremembered, and just fizzle out like some bands do, where they just become has-beens and just it ends up quite bad. And he wanted people to remember the Jam when they were really, really good. But he also wanted to experiment as well.
Is that when they reached the peak and when they was up there and then kaput?
They did indeed. But that's entertainment as well. Mm-hmm. Did you? So going back to that song, right, that featured acoustic guitar all the way through.
Yes.
But over a line in, I can't remember which line it is, there's actually a backwards electric guitar as well.
Oh.
There you go. Goodness. You learn something new every day.
Yeah.
And that was part of the psychedelia bit as well. So you could see he was experimenting with psychedelia.
Yes.
And that type of thing. And he wanted to... And the experimentation was what actually formed the next chapter of his life, which was the Style Council. But when Weller upped and left, literally, it was just announced. It was just like that.
Yes.
Complete shock to Foxton and Buckler.
Yes.
And Weller's father, was it Weller's father who managed the Jam? It was indeed.
Yes, yes.
So he was a, what was he originally? Was he a...
Was he a builder?
Or a car mechanic, or a carpenter, I can't remember what he was.
I can't really remember.
No, we'll put it on the
screen.
I think
he was in the building trade though.
Was he really?
I think.
Yeah, and he just ended up managing...
The Jam.
But he also managed, did you know who else he managed as well?
I don't know, Mr. Moonstomper.
Turning Japanese, the Vapors.
Oh, the Vapors.
Absolutely.
They were a one-hit wonder.
They were a one-hit wonder in the United Kingdom.
Okay.
But they actually went to the United States of America and they were bigger than the Jam in the USA.
Oh, gosh.
Who knew that? But, yeah, and Foxton actually found the Vapors.
Oh, I see.
He found the Vapors. The Jam gave them a couple of gigs and the rest is history. And they turned, they didn't turn Japanese, but you can only get the picture. If you don't know who the Vapors are, we'll put a picture on the screen.
That's amazing.
But that's kind of like a weird fact.
Yes. Yeah.
And why else would you come to Moonstompers but for nothing but weird facts? Because we've got them all, guys. And they're not made up, honestly. And we didn't Google them either. That's just something I just remember.
Yes.
From when I was a youngster.
Oh, yes. In the later 70s, early 80s.
Absolutely. And I can remember that far back.
Oh, yes.
So, moving forward, when Weller left the Jam,
yes,
I think Buckler went home because they did their last gig, their last ever gig, and that was it.
Gosh.
And I think Buckler went home and he just sat there and he thought, now what am I going to do?
Okay.
And it's kind of strange because he sort of dabbled in music, sort of produced music for a bit. Then in 1990, he went off to be a carpenter.
Okay.
Just an ad hoc carpenter.
Yes.
Doing like custom carpentry or carving or whatever it was.
Yes.
As you do. And he did that for a few years.
Oh.
And then went back into production as a music producer.
Yes.
Which is kind of strange. But Buckler never spoke to Weller again. Or they've never been in the same room again, as far as I'm aware. Foxton, however, he ended up in bits and pieces of bands. Then he was with Stiff Little Fingers from 1992, I believe it was 2007. And he hadn't seen Paul Weller for 28 years, or they hadn't made contact.
That's a long time.
Absolutely is. There were 28 years, maybe a bit less actually. And I think when Foxton's wife became unwell, God rest her soul, that he took her to Israel for cancer treatments, and that was the only place where he could actually get this specialist treatment. just to prolong the life a little bit more, and it was none other than Paul Weller who rang up to wish them well.
And that's really nice.
It is, absolutely.
After all that time.
It is. And oh, I think, you know, there was another meeting where there was a gig, and they met each other backstage, had a hug, and literally then Foxton appeared on a couple of Weller's singles, and they actually played the, I think Foxton played live at the Royal Albert Hall with Weller.
Well, talk about bygones be bygones.
But yes. They never ever wanted to put the jam back on the table.
Oh, right.
Weller said that had been in, that was been and gone. Foxton wanted to do it, then Foxton said it was off the table, and it's never been the case, and Buckler's just not done anything since with it.
Gosh.
So it's an absolute shame. But saying that with Buckler, so he actually, when he went back into music production and music,
yes,
they, him and Foxton were in a group called, I believe it was it The Gift?
The Gift.
The Gift.
Yes.
Yes, it was The Gift. And then, wasn't it a tribute band to The Jam? It was called From The Jam.
Can't remember.
So, that's kind of strange, how you can be two-thirds of a band and then end up as a tribute band to your own band. Only bizarre. In England, guys. Only in England. But, yeah, it's... And that shows that the actual draw of that band, in my opinion, and it could be the wrong opinion, was actually Paul Weller.
Oh, yes.
Going back to the Style Council, because what we forgot to mention was what Paul Weller actually did after he left the Jam.
Oh, yes.
And he went to the Style Council, he formed Style Council. Mm-hmm. So that was a completely different spin to the Jam.
Yes.
It was softer, and he wanted to try different things, such as adding brass synthesizers and make it just completely different. He sang with
Tracy Thorn from Everything But The Girl.
Tracy Thorn with Everything But The Girl. Yeah. So now, she became a bit of a pop star in her own rights in the 90s.
Yeah, she alongside Ben Watts as well.
And then, was it not DC Lee?
There's DC Lee as well, yes.
So DC Lee was actually in Wham.
She was.
And she sang in the Style Council.
Oh, yes, yes.
And Paul Weller actually married DC Lee, didn't they? Yes. Or they became partners. Mm-hmm. And they had a child together or something.
They've got a couple of children now, haven't they?
I'm not sure.
I think they've got a girl and a boy.
I'm not quite sure. But the funny thing is, talking of Wham, Paul Weller sang on Band-Aid's Do They Know It's Christmas?
Oh, yes.
Which was, that was an idea by Bob Geldof and Midyear.
Midyear, yes.
Where they gathered everybody together really, really quick, and they wanted to raise money for starving people in Africa.
Yes.
And the upshot was that they were going to make a charity single, and it was star-studded, was it not?
Oh, yes.
So if you're old enough to remember that, it was 1984, was
yes,
it not?
Yes, it was. Christmas 84.
Exactly. And they got everybody in the studio, and Paul Weller was in the studio, and he was on that single. You can actually see it on the video.
Yes, he's there.
And I think he ended up arguing with none other than George Michael.
Oh, no.
There was some sort of arguments.
Oh.
Right, in fact, it was a bust. So the newspapers said, believe it was a bust up. But I think they called each other a few names, and I can't quite remember what the argument was about. Suffice to say that Weller actually said when people made that single, people were just coked up to the eyeballs.
Oh,
there was just copious quantities of cocaine being snorted, and that's how they all got through. Whether that's right or wrong, guys, I don't know, but that's been a pop star for you, isn't it?
The rock and roll lifestyle.
Absolutely. But I often wander back to that, and I always thought, was there something with DC Lee and George Michael before that? I don't know.
Who knows?
But there you go. So, and when the Style Council, right, so their first single, that went straight into the charts.
Okay.
Straight in. And yes. I think it went straight in the top as a top 10 hit, if I remember rightly. I'll put the number on the screen.
Yes.
And the first LP did as well. In fact, successive hits went straight in at the top 10. But by the time they got to the fifth LP, their record label refused to release it.
Oh no.
And it put Paul Weller in a bit of a bind. So at the time, Paul Weller had got his own studios.
Oh, yes.
And literally, because the LP wasn't charted and the record company wouldn't do it, he pretty much lost his shirt on that, and he had to sell his studios.
That's terrible.
Which is awful.
Mm.
But after that, he became... The Star Council actually split off.
Oh, yes.
And he became Paul Weller, so he bounced around for a bit, did smaller gigs, got back on his feet, and he became another hit-making machine like you wouldn't believe.
Yes.
So, Mrs. Moonstomper.
Yes.
What else do you know about the Jam, the Star Council, and Paul Weller?
Oh, the Star Council. You forgot to mention Mr. Moonstomper. And Mick Talbot, the keyboardist with the Star Council.
Talbot, I know that name. Was he with, what band was he with previously?
Texas Midnight Runners.
And?
The Merton Parkers.
The Merton Parkers and the Bureau.
Oh, yes.
The Bureau, there you go. So, showing my age there, guys, obviously. And
yes.
Who was the other girl who sang with them?
Well, the first single that recorded was Speak Like a Child. Tracy Young, the backing vocals, yes.
That was it, that was it. Yes. Did you know Mrs. Moonstomper?
Oh, yes.
Nikki, Paul Weller's sister.
Oh, yes, the famous Nikki.
Actually ran his fan club.
Oh,
and
yes,
and she was paid none other than, ta-da, get ready for it, £5 a week to open the band's fan mail.
Wow, gosh.
In the 70s.
That's what you call a dedicated sister.
Absolutely. But when John passed away, which is Paul's father, in 2009, which is really, really sad, Bruce Fox incidentally attended that funeral.
Yes.
They started going through all the stuff that John had kept in the garage.
Right.
And they unearthed all these sort of archives of the Jam. And there was loads of city films. There was absolutely everything. And they put it in various displays around the United Kingdom, which I thought was a really, really generous thing to do for a family in sight. So, you know, I think Paul Weller is the Modfather.
Mm-hmm.
That is a well-earned title. So, Mrs. Moonstomper, what have we got coming up next time?
We've got bust-ups, bands and groups bust-ups.
Absolutely. such as ska, reggae, two-tone.
Oh, yes.
Northern Soul, etc, etc. You want to stick around and stay tuned to that, because you won't believe the bits and pieces we've got for you on that one, guys. absolutely terrible, but exciting at the same time. That's all we've got time for this week, so we hope you enjoyed this. And just as a quick note, thank you so much for watching.
Yes.
Thank you so much for subscribing. The channel's grown immensely, and we really, really, really wholeheartedly appreciate your support, guys, because without you we'd be absolutely nothing. So that's all we've got time for on this one, guys. So until the next time,
get out your mat, pray to the west.
I'll get out of mine and pray for myself.
Hello, hooray.
What a nice day for the Eton Rifles.
Your face, there's a row going.